So welcome all of you on this free webinar on Internet of Things. So before starting, just a few things I want to tell. Just keep yourself mute always so that it will not disturb the others. And just type yes if you are able to hear me so that we'll proceed further. Just type yes if you're able to hear me in the chat window. Okay. So if you have any questions, any queries, any question, technical question or whatever question, if you have, you can always type that question in the chat window. We will have last 10 minutes before 8 p.m. That we'll keep for the question answer session. By that time, I will just hold all of your question. But if you have any question, then you can always type in the chat window. But keep yourself mute always. So now we'll start this session. So before starting, just 5 minutes about the introduction to our company. We have Axalta System, and we are into IoT solutions and education. We are based out of Hyderabad, and we are world's largest IoT training company, and till now we have trained more than 3,500 professionals worldwide. And this is invented by IITians Piyush Jain and Manish Agarwal, and we have official training partners for Intel Germany, Intel India, then Tata Communication and Infosys and many other corporate clients. And currently we are offering this training. So we are offering basic IoT training, then we are offering corporate IoT training, online and offline both. Then we are offering IoT trainings in analytics, then IoT in MQTT protocol. Then recently we started ThingWorks training, and soon we are launching for this IoT protocol trainings. So now we'll start with the actual protocol. So this is our agenda. So initially we'll see what exactly protocol means and what is exactly difference between protocols, standards and technology. So someone is saying I am not able to hear. So just confirm me, are you able to hear me properly now? So are you guys able to hear me now? Just type yes if you are able to hear me. Okay. So initially we'll start with the protocols, what exactly protocol is, then technology and standards. Then we'll see why in IoT we need the special protocols rather than whatever protocols we have in the web protocols. Then we'll see different RF technologies, and then we'll see messaging protocol. Then we'll compare IoT protocol stack with web protocol stack. So initially, what is meant by protocol? So protocol is nothing but the some set of rules between two communication entities. Like take example of our live session on this GoToMeeting software. Now something information I have in my mind, and that information I want to deliver to all of you guys, right? So I am as a person, I am just making a voice whenever I'm making my information, and you are listening that voice from your ears. But we are using a language, common language, that is English as a language. So English language, we can say it is as a protocol. So it is a some set of rules. So whenever I speak some things, the information I have in my brain, and I also knows the English as a language. So I encode my things or my information into English language. Then I pass that language to you. That information is coming to your ears. Then that going to your brain, and finally your brain decodes that English sentences, English language into meaningful information. So we can say that English is a one of the protocol. So any language, any set of rules, any specific rules or between two entities, we can say as a protocols. So now this is a typical architecture of IoT. If you know basic of IoT, IoT is nothing but the things are connected to internet. They can communicate with each other and they are always connected to internet. So I can say that right now, whatever internet we are using, we as a people, we are using internet in our laptop or mobile. So all those things are connected to internet. But when other than these things will connect to internet, this is a typical architecture I can say. So we have basically three elements in IoT. We have nodes, we are calling it as a nodes. So these are different nodes or devices. Then we have a gateway which connects to cloud platform. So we can have several, we can have 10 or hundreds or thousands devices connected to one gateway. then we can have hundreds or thousands gateways connected to one cloud. So this is a typical architecture of IoT. So now where protocols comes in this all picture? So you can see here between this node to gateway, we have this short range wireless protocol or technology like RF, then ZigBee, Bluetooth. Then from gateway to cloud, we have this Wi-Fi, GPRS, MQTT. So all these things we are going to cover. So this is the place where protocols exactly comes into the IoT. I hope it's very clear to you. So whenever these two devices wants to communicate to cloud or anything, things whenever they want to communicate to cloud, then we can have several of protocols. We can have choice of different protocols. So now we'll begin with the protocol. So before that, we'll see why these special protocols are required in IoT. Always we are using internet from last 20, 30 years. But now why these special protocols are required? So right now, the internet is there, which we are calling it as internet of people. So it means we are using internet for our laptop, PC. So those devices are full-fledged devices. So they have, say, 4 GB of RAM. They have 1 TB of hard disk. In even our mobile phone has a quad core processor. We have 1 GB, 2 GB of RAM. So those all devices which right now we are using are the full-fledged devices. But when things will connect to internet, things can be any smallest device, even your smartwatch, your wearable sensor, even your door sensor. So whatever sensors, whatever things will connect to internet, they are not same as our mobile phone or laptop. They have some constraints in terms of many things. So this is the slide which shows you what the constraints we have in terms of IoT. So whenever IoT end nodes connects to internet, these are the typical constraints. So from end point of view, the device should be self-healing, it should be scalable, it should be secure, it should be addressable. So many devices can be there, it can scale to thousands or billions or millions of nodes. So it should be scalable and each device should be addressable. Then from device point of view, we have limited power, we have limited battery backup. It means, take example of your wearable device. So wearable device generally works with the coin cell or smallest battery. So we want to work like our watches works with the small cell, small coin cell for more than in year. So same thing when device or when things will connect to internet, the things will be smallest. So they should be there will be in constraint in terms of low power, battery operated, limited memory and cost should be low. So these are the constraints in terms of devices. And in terms of network topology, right now whatever topology we are using, just Wi-Fi or GSM, CDMA. But in terms of IoT, assume that in the smallest area, take example of your campus or your college or your home, there can be hundreds or thousands nodes can be possible. So your mesh topology is one of the things that in terms of network topology, we should have a mesh capable, it should be scalable, it should be secure, and it should be addressable and to many of nodes. So this is the one of the requirement from IoT. And when it comes to the messaging protocol, the protocol should be lightweight. It should not consume your bandwidth. Like in case of our home, right now assume that in your home there are 5 members, you, your parents, your children. So now how many devices are there which are connected to internet? Only 4 or 5. But in future, there can be hundreds or thousands of devices will be connected to internet. So their protocol should not jam our bandwidth or network. It should not make any things which will degrade the performance of internet. So protocol should be lightweight. It should be small footprint should be there. So in terms, these are all the constraints are there which are required from IoT point of view. That's why we have some special protocols which are designed for IoT. Now, what is exactly mean by protocol, standards and technology? So protocol is rules, as I told you already. So take example of internet protocol, IP, or take example of HTTP. So I can say it is a one protocol. Now, this protocol can be stacked together and it can be combined to form a complete stack. So whenever we got a complete stack of protocol, we got a stack that we generally call it as a technology. So technology is a activity of design, which as designed for any communication system. So take example of Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. So these are the technology. We are generally calling it as a technology. Some people say it is as a protocol also. Then standards are nothing but the on which standards those technology or protocol are based on. So now I will take example of one protocol or one technology. Say take example of Wi-Fi. So if you are using Wi-Fi as an internet protocol or Wi-Fi for your mobile phone, then in using Wi-Fi you can browse something, then you can download something. So if you are using Wi-Fi protocol, then there is one protocol that is IP, which is nothing, it can be IPv4, it can be IPv6. Then if you are browsing something, then there will be HTTP protocol. Then Wi-Fi is based on IEEE 802.11 standard. So this is how they are interlinked with each other. If take example of ZigBee, then ZigBee is based on 802.11, and ZigBee has their own protocol stack. So there can be different protocols are there when it comes to ZigBee technology. So this is how they are interlinked with each other. So generally we can say protocols are, these are the protocols, these are the technologies, and these are the standards. Now we'll cover this much of IF technology. So as you can see on my screen, these are the different technologies which we have from past, and these are some of the technologies which are specially designed for IoT. So we'll cover it one by one. Then after this technologies, then we'll move to the protocols. We'll see HTTP, then CoAP and MQTT, and some of the special protocols. So initially start with the ZigBee. So ZigBee is one of the technology. So RF is a radio frequency, Vijay. So yeah, one point I forgot. Whenever this, any technology when you are using, finally data flows in terms of RF waves only. Like when two persons or two animals talk with each other, we are using we are using English as a protocol, but we are using voice as a medium, or voice is the actual information which flows, or voice, or the, we can say it is a vibration in the air. But when it comes to these technologies and protocol, final information flows through the RF technology only. So whenever you dial a mobile phone, and if you call to your friends, finally mobile phone is connected to the tower, internet tower, say Airtel is a tower. So from your tower to mobile, the communication happens to RF technology. So this nothing but the RF. Now Bluetooth, ZigBee, we'll start with the ZigBee. So ZigBee is, I guess, new to you. So because it's not that much popular for consumer point of view, but when it comes to the IoT, so typically in IoT we are not going to browse something, we are not going to download something, we just want to give some few bits of information and we want to receive some form of information. I will give you one example. Take example of home automation. So home automation is, you can see from two point of view. One is you will gather information from your home, what is your temperature, what is your humidity, what is the level of your light, and you will send to internet for analysis purpose. So whenever you are sending a temperature, you will just say temperature 25 degree, that's it. So you, just a few of bits or bytes of information. And this is one of the example. And whenever suppose you want to control your home, suppose from a remote location, if you want to turn on and off your fridge, your washing machine, your fridge, your fan, your tube light, if you want to automate, if you want to monitor, if you want to control it remotely, then you will just make actuation like on and off. So finally the node which are going to receive information, that will be in a few of bits or bytes. Or when compared to our web technology, when we are using internet on our browser, then we watch a YouTube video, we download something. So that is different from IoT application. So in IoT application, we want a protocol, we want a technology which will be a low in terms of data rate, in terms of power, in terms of packet size. So ZigBee, as you can see on my screen, these are the some of the technical specifications of ZigBee. ZigBee works with the ISM band, that is 2.4 gigahertz worldwide. This is ISM band, RF band, which is specially given for ZigBee. And the maximum data rate supported by ZigBee is only 250 kbps. So you can see it's not in mbps, like when you are browsing something you want internet speeds to be mbps, but it is just 250 kbps for ZigBee. So this is a typical when it comes to the range. So when two Zigbee nodes communicate with each other, we can have a range from 100 to 300 of bits, or just 10 to 30 meters of the range they can cover. And for outdoor application, it can go to the 100 meters also. And then why we are using Zigbee, why not the other? So one of the major advantage I can say, or the major features of Zigbee, is we can form a mesh topology using Zigbee. So these are the different topology you can see on my screen. Star, we have mesh, we have tree. So I will give you one example. Assume that there is one Wi-Fi router placed in your home. Then maximum distance, how much maximum distance you can reach with that Wi-Fi. Assume that you have 100 devices connected to one Wi-Fi network, but all 100 devices need to be in the range of Wi-Fi. If you are going away from your home, then you cannot connect to internet because of Wi-Fi, because Wi-Fi works with this star topology. So this is a Wi-Fi router and there can be multiple devices connected, so we are calling it a star topology. But Zigbee can form a mesh topology, tree topology. See, we can cover 10 or hundreds of kilometers of distance. There can be 65,000 of node in one mesh network topology. So this is one of the advantage of Zigbee. And what a typical application in terms of IoT. So we can use it for building automation, then we can use it for some personal healthcare application, then for remote asset and asset control and monitoring, then some residential control, that is a control of the lighting and all other things. Then some of the other things in our home, and some of the consumer products like TV or refrigerator or any other things, we can control all these things using Zigbee network. So this is the one of the application of Zigbee. Z-Wave is also one of the common technology in terms of IoT. So basically this Z-Wave is built for the residential control. So it works even lesser in terms of data rate than Zigbee. So it works only up to hundreds of kbps, and it works with a 900 megahertz of the band, and we can have 230 of the nodes connected to one Z-Wave. And one of the major difference between Z-Wave and Zigbee is Z-Wave is interoperable. It means two Z-Wave, when connects to each other, they knows what they are exactly talking about. But in terms of Zigbee, we need to define the application layer. So in terms of Zigbee and Z-Wave, Z-Wave is a more compact or more constant in terms of Zigbee. Now next is a Bluetooth. So Bluetooth is obviously popular for all of you guys. So we are using Bluetooth from last 10 or more years in our mobile phone. So take example of your two mobile phones. When you are sharing some information, then generally that two phones should be in that range, say hundreds or the 10s of the meter. So Bluetooth is designed generally for this point-to-point network, to between two mobiles, or between your wireless headphone and your mobile, or between your wireless printer and your mobile. So this is how Bluetooth works. So generally it works with the standard range, but the Bluetooth consumes a much power compared to Zigbee. So to avoid that drawback, Zigbee standards has designed some special protocol. It's called as a Bluetooth low energy. So Bluetooth low energy is a future, it's new technology. We can say it is Bluetooth smart, or Bluetooth 4.0 onwards, we are it comes to the Bluetooth low energy. So now the new mobile phones we are having is a Bluetooth low energy compatible. So they reduce some of the output power and some of the data rates. So that's why it's consumed the very low power. And these are the typical application. It can be used for the automotive, then smart security, then sports and health related things. We can use BLE. Then Wi-Fi, all of you knows Wi-Fi very much popular. So it is widely developed technology compared to other technology. Why it is a obvious choice for developers? Because using Wi-Fi, you can directly reach to internet, because Wi-Fi follows a complete TCP/IP stack, whereas Bluetooth and Zigbee and Z-Wave follows their own protocol stack. So that's why using Bluetooth and using Zigbee, you cannot reach to internet, but using Wi-Fi, you can reach to internet. So this is one of the major advantage of Wi-Fi, I can say. So Wi-Fi works with the 2.4 or 5 gigahertz of the band. And generally data rate supported by Wi-Fi is the highest, I can say, in terms of RF. It is a maximum, it can go up to 600 Mbps with the latest Wi-Fi technology. Now right now we are using Wi-Fi in your mobile phone, but for IoT application, this is the Wi-Fi module, small Wi-Fi module. ESP8266 is one of the popular model if you are aware with this embedded technology. So it is just a $2 or $3 of its cost. We can integrate that Wi-Fi chip in this of the consumer products, so this all device can connect to internet. But the one of the major drawback of Wi-Fi is it consumes a lot of power or a lot of battery backup. So this is one of the drawback of Wi-Fi. Now the next is a cellular. So this cellular is already we are using for mobile, but IoT application, in IoT application we can make use of cellular for longer distance. So for if you want to reach a longer distance, larger distance, if you want a mobility, then we can use this existing cellular technology and we can work with this and this with this GPRS or GSM or LTE technology, we can reach to the largest of the distance. So now I will give you two example when we should use cellular, when we should use the Wi-Fi. So in terms of home automation, if you are making IoT enabled home, smart home, then Wi-Fi you can use because it works with the limited range. But now for outside environment, if you want to make your smart vehicle which you want to connect to internet, that time you cannot use Wi-Fi. It's obvious it is outdoor application, that time you can use the cellular. Now cellular and Wi-Fi we are using from last 10 years, so those are not specially designed for IoT application. Then which are the technologies which are specially designed for IoT and which achieves the longer, that we'll cover in the coming slide. Now 6LoWPAN is one of the emerging technology. Now as I told you already, advantage of ZigBee and BLE is that they consumes a very short amount of power. Why? Because they are standardized by IEEE 802.15.4, whereas Wi-Fi is standardized by IEEE 802.11. So if we are using IEEE 802.15.4, we are getting the advantage of low power and we are getting the advantage of mesh technology, but we are not getting the advantage of connecting internet directly. Now which is the technology which are giving the both advantages? So 6LoWPAN. So 6LoWPAN is the one of the technology which combines the top layer from the Wi-Fi and bottom layer of ZigBee. So you can see it works with the IP protocol and we can works with the all existing protocol from TCP/IP stack from this top portion, and at the bottom portion it works with the mesh architecture or 802.15.4 standard. So it's combination of personal area network with the IP reachability. So 6LoWPAN is nothing but the IPv6 over low power personal area network. So each node in this world, or if we are using one of the major advantage of IPv6 is that we can give IP, public IP, to each and every node, each and every person worldwide. So we have combination of 2 raised to 256 combination, that is almost infinity number of each address, each nodes can be addressed with IPv6. So using 6LoWPAN, all device will have a unique IPv6 address and all those device can connect to internet directly without needs of any gateway device. So this is one of the advantage of 6LoWPAN technology. Now as I talking you previously, which is the technology which is designed for longer range, similar to cellular, but which consumes a low power, is a Sigfox, and LoRa is one of the, these two are there. So if you are using cellular technology, then cellular we can reach to maximum distance, but we cannot achieve the low power capability. Then this is the Sigfox is the alternative to this RF, alternative to this Wi-Fi and cellular. So it's coming in between Wi-Fi and cellular. So we can have a distance of 30 to 50 kilometers in the rural, and in urban we can have 3 to 10 kilometers of distance. So it is almost similar to cellular technology, but it works in narrow band range. So we can have only 10 to 100 bits per second as a data rates. So compared to our classic cellular technology, it's around more than 100 times better. So take example of cellular, then we can have battery backup. If take example of 2.2 years of battery backup, but using Sigfox we can have 20 years of battery backup. So this is how we are getting advantage of cellular plus Wi-Fi. So in we can have a low data rates and we can reach a longer distance. So Sigfox is for machine to machine application, for IoT application, this Sigfox idea is coming in the future. So that will directly connect to internet in for outdoor application. LoRaWAN is also one of the technology is similar to Sigfox. Sigfox. It's also have we can have 15 of the kilometers range with this LoRa. Even this Tata Communications are launching this LoRaWAN in the India in the future. So we might get this LoRaWAN technology similar to our right now what we are using as a 2G, 3G or 4G for our mobile communication. But for IoT communication, for outdoor application in future, we might get this LoRaWAN in India. In many of the countries, in European countries, there are already these networks are already designed, LoRa and Sigfox are already there. Now, when we compare all this technology, so this is the scale you can see here. So generally this Zigbee, Z-Wave and RFID and Wi-Fi we are using for home area network within the limited range. But if we want to have the longer distance, then we can go to this LoRa and Sigfox. And if you want to go even more, then we can use this existing GPRS 3G, 4G. So these are the technology, depending on our application, we can choose any technology. So typically this is IoT network. So you can see here, things are connected to internet using different technology. So we can use this Zigbee within this WAN. We can use Bluetooth within this personal area network. Then these existing nodes can connect to tower using LTE technology, or we can use this Sigfox or LoRa or whatever technology we want to use. So this is a typical IoT network using all this technology. Now if we compare all this technology in terms of range, in terms of data rate, then this is how we can segregate the application area in the three or four categories: control and monitoring. So control and monitoring is specially designed for IoT application. As I told you already, if I want to automate my home, I just want to monitor my home and I want to control my home. So guys, right now I'm just holding all of your question. You can type all your question in chat window, but last 10 minutes we will answer all these questions. So right now you can start with the question if you have. Now Zigbee and Bluetooth, you can see here, these are limited in terms of range and in terms of data rate. So that's why we are using this Zigbee and Bluetooth for monitoring and control application. Whereas cellular, in terms of range, it is giving me the highest range, and Wi-Fi and this ultra wideband are giving me the highest in terms of data rate. So we have four kind of application area, that is control and monitoring. Then voice communication is popular with the cellular. Then data communication is popular with Wi-Fi, and this is video application. So typically IoT application falls under this Bluetooth and Zigbee. Now this is also one of the comparison chart between this existing GSM and LTE compared with this Sigfox and LoRa. So obviously this LTE and GSM is giving me the highest range, but Sigfox and LoRa are giving me similar range, but with some limited data rates and with limited range. So this is the data rates. We are getting just a few of bits per seconds for Sigfox and few of kilobits for LoRa. But whereas for LTE, that is a 4G technology, we are getting much of the data rates, and GSM also we are getting much of data rates. Now coming back to the protocol, that is a messaging protocol. As we have seen, right now we have seen the technology. So now we'll come to the messaging protocol. Those resets at the application layer. So these are the common protocols, are actually protocols which we are using, that is HTTP or MQTT or CoAP or XMPP or MQP. I will give example of a mobile phone. Say in mobile phone, if your mobile phone is connected to your home router, and if you are going to google.com, then you are say opening a Google Chrome browser. Then in Google Chrome browser, you are just typing http://google.com and you are hitting the enter, and you are getting the web page of Google. So right now what happening behind this is, your mobile phone is a device which is connected to Wi-Fi router of your home. So you are using Wi-Fi technology to reach to internet. But when a browser is communicating with Google server, there should be a protocol. So you are using HTTP as a common protocol for all web application. So here you are using HTTP as a protocol, Wi-Fi as a technology. And if you are using your 2G or 3G or 4G, then you are using this CDMA or GSM as a technology. So this is how your mobile phone actually communicating with the Google server, which is hosted in somewhere in some country, say in California. In California, there is a server of Google. Finally, you are getting a packet from that Google server, and that packet's formation is going through all this network structure, and finally that comes to your mobile phone, and your Google Chrome or your Opera browser forming that information in form of web page, because your web page understand HTTP as a protocol. So this is how this IoT how protocols are there. Now HTTP, we all, I'm just muting all of you guys, just a second. Okay, now HTTP is a common protocol we are using from past years. Now this MQTT, CoAP, XMPP and MQTT, I hope these are new for you. So we are covering all this protocol. So now this is how things are connected to internet. So HTTP, so RESTful is the architecture. Using this REST architecture, we can use HTTP, existing HTTP protocol for IoT application. So generally in HTTP, we have two entities. One is a client and one is a server. So client always requests to server for data, or it can be information, and server always respond to the client. So here the disadvantage of HTTP is that server cannot directly push to the client. Always client has to request to server for to get some information. Now if you are building a home automation application, that is IoT enabled home, and if your home is connected to internet, then directly your home cannot get any information from server. You as a home needs to always give a request to server. Like in mobile phone, when you are browsing a google.com, then your Google browser or your Chrome browser gives the HTTP request to Google server. So this is how RESTful HTTP works. So we have different methods in HTTP. We have get, post, put, delete. So get is to get data from server. Post is pushing data to server. And then we have delete and other things that we are not going to cover in details. So this is general structure of HTTP. We can use this HTTP in IoT application, but disadvantage of HTTP is it is a very much a larger header size. So when, say example, if you are sending a temperature data, so 25 degree temperature, whenever you are sending to server, then along with this 25 as a value, it say it is a 10 bytes of information, then along with this 10 bytes of information, HTTP attach its header that it can be 300, 200 of bytes. So finally you are getting data, say 350 of bytes. So it is a very rich protocol, very verbose protocol. So generally for IoT application, HTTP is not that much suitable because it consumes lot of headers, lot of network, in terms of congestion, in terms of also there we cannot achieve that low power and more battery backup. So to limit this drawback, we have some special protocol. So MQTT is one of the protocol. So it is a lightweight protocol specially designed for IoT application, IoT or a machine to machine application. So it uses just 2 bytes of header, and it is completely based on publish subscribe model, whereas HTTP works with the request response, but HTTP works with the publish subscribe model that I will explain you in the coming slide. So generally this MQTT we are using for wireless sensor application or any home automation or any IoT application. If you have multiple nodes communicating with multiple nodes, then MQTT is the best option. So this is a typical structure of MQTT. In MQTT, we have several clients connected to one common broker. So whenever any clients sends data to broker, we are saying it as a publish. So publish is a things, it means these clients sending data to broker. So this is how publish works. And whenever broker sends data to any clients, we are saying it as a subscriber. So this is a structure of typical MQTT. But compared to HTTP, major advantage of MQTT is that here we no need to do a continuous polling. Directly broker can push data to any client. So I will give you one of the example. This MQTT works with a topic. So whenever you publish something, you need to define a topic, and whenever you subscribe something, you need to define a topic. Assume that this is one my publisher and it is my home, and this is my control room. Now from home I am getting a 25 degree as my temperature, then I am publishing my 25 degree to my broker, and if I am as a client, I am as a control room, if I am interested to get the data, then I will just subscribe to that topic, that is a temperature. If I am subscribing to temperature, then whenever there is data available to broker, it will directly push to broker. Sorry, it will directly push to this subscriber node. So here we will get this advantage of not to continuously poll to server. Directly broker can push data to any of the clients. So this is one of the advantage of MQTT compared to HTTP. Now CoAP is I forgot one thing, that MQTT is an application layer protocol. So existing at the bottom, MQTT uses TCP only. So MQTT works on TCP as a transport layer protocol. CoAP is one of the protocol. Compared to MQTT, it works on the UDP. It not works on TCP. So CoAP is specially designed for IoT application, but for a few of the nodes, for point to point, or just to control or just to monitor a few of the nodes. So this is a typical structure of CoAP. So in CoAP, we have the CoAP server, then we can CoAP clients. So whenever two entities connecting to over internet, they can use CoAP as a protocol. So advantage of CoAP is it's just small header, so it just have 4 bytes of header, and we have this same kind of request and response model. Similar to the HTTP, we can have get, post, put, delete as a methods which are using in the CoAP. But CoAP uses UDP, it not works on TCP. So if you are familiar with this TCP and UDP, UDP is a user datagram protocol. There we don't have authentication. We are not having retransmission. So UDP consumes a low bandwidth or low power consumption compared to TCP. So CoAP works on UDP. Now in terms of IoT application, how we can build this? Say these are your things. You are sensing a humidity, you are sensing a temperature, you are controlling your bulb or tube light. Then you can use this CoAP, you can use this gateway device, and this is your cloud and this is your control room. Then if you are using MQTT, then if your this gateway is capable of understanding this MQTT, then this can connect to this things can connect to MQTT broker, and then your cloud can connect, can take data from this broker. If you are using CoAP, then you can exist, you can use this CoAP as a protocol to connect in between this device. Also, one of the advantage of CoAP that we can have this in between device communication, we can form this mesh kind of architecture. So combine this protocol, so you can have this choice of MQTT node, CoAP node. So if you're using CoAP, it will go via this IPv6, UDP and CoAP. If you're using this MQTT, it will go via this TCP and MQTT as a protocol. Now XMPP is one of the protocol. It is developed for instant messaging. So to connect people to people for instant messaging, this is one of the protocol, XMPP. It is a lightweight protocol similar to our previous two protocol. It works over TCP, and it is not designed for fast communication, but generally for to connect the things and just to access the things from internet. This is one of the protocol for IoT application. So here all these individual things we can connect to individual server using this XMPP as a protocol. Then MQPP is one of the protocol. So it is advanced message queuing protocol. So generally for previous all protocol we have seen for client to client communication or between device to device or between device to server. But AMQP's protocol is specially designed for business application, for server to server communication. So take example of banking application. In banking application, there can be thousands or lakhs of transactions coming per day, and those are running in their servers. So AMQP is an advanced protocol which is designed not to lose any message. It is a very secure protocol for business application. So two servers or multiple servers can use this AMQP as a protocol, and using this protocol, in between this server, we can have a device or we can have server to server communication. It works on the reliable network, that is a TCP, because TCP is more reliable compared to UDP. Also, it giving acknowledgement. So whenever any device receives that information, receiver sends that acknowledgement. So it is a very strictly and very point to point communication, and we have this acknowledgement, and we can have this secure information, and we can have multiple transaction communication between multiple servers. Now, if you are comparing all this protocol, CoAP, HTTP and MQTT, Then HTTP is working with that. We can have choice of TCP or UDP both, but it works with the request and response. CoAP also works with the request and response, but MQTT works with the publish and subscribe. So here we don't have any methods, get, post, put and delete. Here just publish and subscribe with the topic. CoAP works with UDP, whereas MQTT works with TCP. And this is also another the difference. We are not going to that much details, but generally CoAP and MQTT are consumes very low bandwidth, very small footprint and small battery, whereas HTTP consumes a lot of power. Now to conclude this our discussion, finally we have this web protocol stack and we have this IoT stack. Now I will just revise all things what I taught from last 40 or 45 minutes. So we have started with our standards and then we have seen this Zigbee, Bluetooth and all this technology. Then we move to this IP and then this HTTP and CoAP. So if you are talking about a web application which are running in your PC, then this is the stack which are running in your PC or mobile phone. Say you are running a web application, it can be browsing something, it can be watching a video, watching a YouTube, download something. So this is a typical web application you are running. And when you are running this web application, typically you are using this HTML as a message format, or it can be XML. So whenever browse you are getting data in your browser, it is coded in this HTML as a format. So this is the data types you are using. And you are using this HTTP protocol for your browsing, then DHCP protocol for your getting the addresses, then DNS for getting the host resolution, then other protocols. Then at the after this application protocol, at the transport layer you are using TCP, mostly you are using TCP as a reliable protocol. Then finally you are using IP, it can be IP or IPv4 at a network layer. So if you are familiar with this OSI structure, then at application you are using this HTTP protocol with XML or HTML as a format. Then at network layer you are using TCP. Then at a transport layer using TCP. At network layer using IPv4. So mostly we are using IPv4s now. Till now we are not our network is not that much using IPv6. And finally your PC is connected to internet either through Wi-Fi or either through internet. So you are using this standard, it can be IEEE 802.11. So this is a typical web application. So it is designed with a very verbose structure with much of RAM, much of memory and all those things. But when it comes to the IoT stack, so this is a stack. So now we'll compare this with the web stack. So typically for IoT application, instead of web application, now you are running a IoT application. So IoT application is nothing but a device management. You are getting information as a monitoring, or you are controlling with the controlling. So here instead of this XML and HTML, you are not going to browse something, you just want data as a data. So you can use this binary format or JSON as a simple format. Here you are not caring about the format of data. Like if you are watching a movie, you need to get a movie in form of pictures show. And if you are browsing something, then there should be some format which you should get on your browser. But generally for IoT application, we don't want that much, because when things will connect to internet, take example of your watch or your fridge, they don't need to browse something. They just want a data. They just want to receive a data to make it on and off, or they just want to send a data. So format is just a binary or just a JSON format. Now when it's come to the application layer protocol, then we are using this CoAP, MQTT, XMPP, AMQP. So compared to this HTTP and all these protocols, in IoT typically we are using this MQTT, CoAP and XMPP protocol. Now generally for web application we are using TCP, but generally for IoT application UDP is much popular compared to TCP, but we can use TCP also. As I told you, MQTT uses TCP, but UDP is a ideal choice for IoT application. Now compared to IPv4, typically in the future IPv6 will be more popular for IoT application. And if you are using 6LoWPAN technology, then existing 6LoWPAN technology will come to this layer, as we can have this complete stack with 6LoWPAN technology. Now compared to this Wi-Fi and the standards, Wi-Fi and Ethernet, here in IoT application you will use this IEEE 802.15.4, which is a low power personal area network. That is your just mesh network of ZigBee or BLE or any other things. So this is how Wi-Fi stacks we can compare to web technology, web stack. So to conclude this, so we are just end of our discussion. So now I will just take a few of the questions, what questions we have. And if you have any further question, then we can take these questions. So just a second, guys, just give me a few seconds, guys. So Sandeep is asking, okay, I will start from the top. Sunit is asking, does this technology support encryption and decryption? So yes, Vinit, all this technology have their own encryption and decryption logic. Like in Bluetooth, we have cryptography as their own increment and decrement. ZigBee uses their own encryption. Wi-Fi uses their own encryption and decryption. But as protocol, because our technology become more robust, it is more secure. It means Wi-Fi is more secure compared to ZigBee and Bluetooth because it has a much wider header. So security, that security padding and all bits are much larger. So that's why it's more secure. But all this technology have their encryption and decryption. So also he's asking what is mean by license and unlicensed. So license are the range of the RF band. Whenever those technologies are deploying in the world or in the country, they need to give some money to the government. Like whenever this Airtel or Reliance or these all these service providers are, they're starting their business, they are purchasing the license band from business. So you must have seen this 2G's or this all these things. So those are falls under license version. We need to pay for that band. But unlicensed bands are the completely free bands. There no need to pay something for this unlicensed band. Then Dhananjay is asking, what is NB-IoT? Where does it fit? So Dhananjay, can you tell me the NB, what exactly full form? I'm not getting this node B or IoT, what is it? Okay, then Sandeep is asking, does MQTT handles millions of subscriber? So MQTT, in MQTT we have two things. One is a client and one is a broker. So there is a one thing you need to understand first. Whenever you are selecting MQTT protocol, first thing is to choose selection of broker, then selection of client library. So it depends on broker whether he has that capability of connecting that much subscriber or not. Also broker have different features of bridging and clustering. We can stack different broker. We can have primary broker, we can have secondary broker. So we can have multiple broker also which are stacked together. It depends on broker to handle that much of subscriber, depends on the broker. So even in Axelta, we are having full-fledged training on MQTT. There we have 3 days of complete training on using hands-on, using hardware and the theory. Both there we are teaching all this MQTT protocol, and we are having tens of the practicals to cover all this technology. So then someone is asking, which is more secure? So security, it depends, as I told you already, it depends on the technology and technology. So Wi-Fi is more secure, I can say, compared to this Z-Wave and ZigBee and all those things. Yeah, Abhishek, yeah, Facebook Messenger works on MQTT. Initially, when Facebook Messenger has launched, they were not started with this MQTT. So they were facing issue with the battery backup of mobile. But nowadays, Facebook Messenger uses MQTT protocol internally. So that's why they reduce that drawback of the more power consumption. So Abhishek is asking, where database stay in MQTT? So a broker is there. So generally broker doesn't have that feature of the recording. It just do a function of the filtering of message. But there can be some brokers, or you can connect any database to connect to your broker. Then we can connect any IoT platform to connect to broker. Even Axelta platform is there. We have our own platform, that is Osmosis platform. So our platform is connected to broker. We have already deployed the broker of MQTT broker. So there we are storing database. We are storing a client's information in the database. So it depends on your architecture. You can store in your database also. So Ankit is asking how to record. So actually we are recording this session, then we'll publish this on our website, so then you can you can make a reuse of this. So Abhishek is asking how can I get post request to gateway. So gateway is a device which connects to internet. So Abhishek, you are not giving any gate and post request to gateway. Gateway is a device which connects to internet. So when you are using a server, so a server server needs to understand that protocol. If you are using HTTP protocol, then actually HTTP is a protocol which is understanding this gate and post. Gateway just acting as a middle agents to connect to your gateway. Take example of ZigBee and Bluetooth. Then ZigBee and Bluetooth uses their own stack. You cannot connect using ZigBee and Bluetooth to internet. Then you should have a gateway device. So gateway device will help you to reach to cloud, to internet, if you are using BLE and ZigBee. So this is how get and post request comes from server only. So is Abhishek asking how one can static IP or gateway. So Abhishek, in our, say, take example of Wi-Fi. In typically in Wi-Fi we have a private network. Every PC is getting a private IP address. So there we have static IP already. So I can say private IP. So using this you cannot directly connect to internet, right? Because it is a private. But there are different methods are there. One is the UDP punch hole is the technology or the method, or you can use MQTT and CoAP is the best choice to avoid this drawback of static IP. So what is the scope of architecture and developer? So obviously, as I told you, IoT is a combination of embedded networking and the cloud things. So when we are designing cloud things, so there is always designing is there in terms of Java for this cloud development and platform development. When it comes to the embedded things, for things point of view, there is a development in terms of embedded point of view. When it comes to the networking, there is a scope in terms of networking. So it is IoT is a combination of all this: Java developer plus network engineer plus embedded developer. So it's combination of all the developers from all the point of view. Narrowband IoT. So as I told you, Dhananjay, Sigfox and this LoRaWAN is a narrowband technology, whereas cellular technology which we are using as it is 2G, 3G, 4G, it is a very very rich which is handling Mbps of the data range. But narrowband, when things needs to connect to internet for outdoor application as a mobile phone, then the Sigfox and LoRa are their technology which works in this narrowband range. So Vinita is asking about the interface, this interference between different Sigfox network. So when your mobile phone connects to your tower, we are getting an IP address. So when you connect to any subscriber things, that gives the addressing. So that is done by that provider of your service provider of your Sigfox on whatever network is there. So generally right now the Sigfox and all this LoRa are coming in the future technology. So it is mostly developed in the European countries. So that's why we are not getting that technology as of now in the India. So this is how they are getting address. But in terms of interference, they will not interfere between each other because they will have their own modulation kind of technology, or they will have their own structure. So they will not interfere between that at much. So will not have that much of interference issue. So Abhijit is asking how to control remote device working on Zigbee network connected to internet and using real time. So Abhishek, I will just give you one brief overview of that your question. So assume that you want to control your fan, tube light and washing machine through internet and you want to have a Zigbee. Then first thing is that you will connect a Zigbee end node in your all devices. So you will have three Zigbee end node in your all three devices, that is a fridge, a washing machine and fan. Then all these three Zigbee node will communicate to other Zigbee node, that is a coordinator node. So typical architecture of Zigbee is we have three kind of nodes. We have gateway, we have router, we have end node and we have coordinator. So all this end node will send data to coordinator. So you will get that data in the coordinator. Now finally coordinator, you will connect to your gateway. So gateway can be Wi-Fi, it can be GSM. If you are using home as a standstill application, then you can have a small chip, that is ESP266 chip, which will take data from Zigbee as a coordinator node and then you can connect to internet, that will push data to server. And if you are running an outdoor application, then you can interface a GSM board with the SIM card. It will connect to existing tower. It can have a 2G, 3G, 4G channel and you can use a HTTP protocol or any protocol to get data to server. So this is how Zigbee and all this, you can use a gateway to control and monitor your existing node. So gateway is a device which connects to internet. So says there are smallest embedded device are there from multiple vendors, from Texas, from multiple embedded vendors are there, Texas or Philips or many are there. So those are manufacturing for these gateway devices. I'm not talking about your Wi-Fi which are placed in your home. Gateway can be your own build small gateway for IoT application. So this is how your typical application work for home automation. But for outdoor application, say for smart parking, then you can use a GSM or any other outdoor application. So Abhishek is asking how HTTP. So say, as I told you already, if your things, that is things which you want to connect to internet, if you are using, if you want to use a Wi-Fi, then you will just run a HTTP server or you can run HTTP client on your thing. And if you are running a HTTP server, then you can get that access of your own server, own hosted TCP server from your private network. Or you can build HTTP client to connect to internet. So you can use this HTTP. So if you want to send a data of temperature, then you can use a method of post. And if you want to get a data from server, then you can make use of get as a HTTP REST architecture. So Sandeep is asking, what is the best technology in terms of 10 kilometers and less than 10 kbps of and least power consumption? So in terms of data rates, it is a few of kilobytes. So I can, whatever what pictures comes in my mind is a Sigfox and LoRa for is more suitable for you, Sandeep, for this coming to the your application. But right now if you don't have this LoRa and Sigfox, then you can use Wi-Fi with the smaller of data bytes. You can use MQTT protocol to avoid your more of your bandwidth and more of your battery backup. But if you want to reach this 10 kilometers of distance, then either you have to use a GSM board, because MQTT is an application protocol, but at the bottom there it works on TCP/IP only. So you can use a GSM board to connect to get this 10 kilometer of distance, and then after GSM to after getting this TCP/IP stack, then at application layer you can use MQTT protocol for this few hundreds of kilobytes of data. So it is 8 p.m. guys, so I hope you enjoyed this session, and also we'll record this session and you can watch this later also on from our web page. And these are the trainings which we are offering, so you can enroll for this any of the course in the future if you want. And so thanks guys, and we'll end up this session now. And thanks for your participation and thanks for your nice questions.